look at your neighbor and say, this is still God's house.
Still God's house.
I know there's some good food somewhere. But look at them and say, this is not church's chicken. Amen. Praise God. So we got a 10-minute delay on this service when we started because of a chicken. Trying to get the chicken in place. So you got to give me at least 10 extra minutes. And I'm not a motivational speaker. I don't care whether you say amen, shout, or whatever. I got an assignment. Come on, somebody. I don't have an agenda. I got an assignment. Hallelujah. Somebody say, how long you preach? I said, till I get through. After a plane. Years ago, I had a pastor in the office of a denominational church that was used to about two songs and a sermonette of 20 minutes. He sat me down in his office. He said, son, how long are you preaching? When do you give the altar call? I said, Holy Ghost. He said, what? I thought, oh God, I'm at that place. I just said, Holy Ghost. He said, what? Praise God. How did I know? It ain't my service. Praise God. Amen. It's his. Amen. Praise God. So, bear with us. Hallelujah. There will be two crowds in here. Those that enjoy and those that endure. But you both be in bliss. Because if you're enduring, you need patience. That's what endurance means. And God said in his word in Luke 21 and 19, in your patience or endurance, you'll possess your soul. So, amen. Be blessed. Either way. Hallelujah. Ephesians 5 verses 18. Somebody say, be not drunk.
Be not drunk.
Hallelujah. I'll preach about that in just a moment. With wine. Somebody say fermented wine. Alcoholic wine. Look at your neighbor and say, thou shalt not wine. Boy, I'd love to tell the church that more often than I do. How you doing, brother? So tell me, I got a battle with the gout and lost my shout. Don't know if I'm ever going to get out. They just some folks you learn not to ask how they do it. Amen. Nobody look at nobody. Especially right now. If you're lady, don't look at your hug. He does it a lot. Wherein is excess? Excess means to dispiciate. It simply means to waste. Somebody shout, it's a waste. That's why they call it getting wasted. Yeah. But be filled with the Spirit. Somebody say, but. You and Stanley can sit back on your butt if you'd like to on that one. Everyone that butt words, praise God. Thank you, Jesus. But be filled with the Spirit. The Ephesian writer here, which I believe was Paul the Apostle, he's speaking to the church at Ephesus, and he's given them an analogy. He's given them some contrast, not so much as just a comparison, but he's speaking in metaphors here, and he's saying, you know what it means to be drunk with wine. He's talking to some folks that used to be out there in the world. I'm talking to some this morning, too. Come on, I know we act like we never did nothing wrong. Come on, somebody. Act like we never went somewhere we ain't supposed to go. Said things we weren't supposed to say. Come on, I know we often forget. Look at your neighbor and say, whatever you do, don't forget where you come from. Amen. Lord of God, if you forget where you come from, your nose will be tilted up in the air. If it was sprinkled, you'd drown. You get holy, you get posh, you forget where you come from. Amen. Amen. And so he's talking to some people that well know what it means to get drunk with wine. And he's telling them, be not drunk with wine. Where is it? Excess. It's a waste. It's a waste. Somebody say it's a waste. I have never seen nobody whose marriage was just on the rocks, just simply going through, amen, hell itself. And they said, this was their testimony. Boy, we went out and got drunk last night and their marriage got better. You ever met anybody that got drunk and things got better? Come on, somebody. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. That don't happen. Somebody said that don't happen. The Bible said in Proverbs 20, verses 1, wine is a mocker, and strong drink is raging, and he that's deceived thereby is not wise. Ain't it amazing? The devil puts on a bottle and a can Budweiser, but God, long before they ever claimed that title Budweiser, amen, God said, Bud, you ain't wise. If you drink it, somebody say strong drink is raging. You've heard of the spirit of rage. Somebody say the spirit of rage. In anger. That alcohol is not some disease. It's a demon. It's a devil. That spirit of addiction is a devil. Somebody say it's a devil. spirit of rage. It causes rage. It causes heartbreak. It causes turmoil. It brings people to death before their time. There's nothing good about alcohol. Somebody say amen on me. Somebody can say amen on faith or on credit. Come on, somebody. You might not be able to say it in just a few minutes. Hallelujah. Take me to my next scriptures. Before I can preach really where I want to go with this in the spirit, I got to announce in the flesh what I'm not advocating. I got to preach against something before I stand for something. You understand what I'm saying? Go to those next scriptures in Proverbs, because I want to make some things plain before we get into the topic. I'm really going to preach from the latter part of Ephesians 5:18 about being filled with the Spirit. But we got to talk, amen, when God speaks about don't be drunk with wine, because he's about to use some contrast here. He's about to use some comparisons to how when you get filled with the Spirit, some things that will happen that are kind of singular in metaphoric terms, amen, with being filled with the Holy Ghost. And we got the book of Proverbs 23. Put it on up. Hallelujah. Who hath woe? Yeah, that's it. Who hath woe and who hath sorrow? Who hath contentions? That means fightings and brawlings. Who hath babblings? Somebody say babblings. Somebody shout diarrhea of the mouth. Belly aching, running off at the mouth. You're babbling. Not making no sense. Talking stupid, crazy. Come, who hath wounds without cause? Somebody say wounds without cause. Pains without any purpose. Who hath redness? Check this out now. Eyes. Who hath redness of eyes? It's showing us a drunk. Go ahead. They that tarry long in wine, they that go to seek mixed wine. Mixed wine means wine that had been mixed with different fruits, more like your fruit cocktail drinks. Come on, man. Yeah. Look not thou upon the wine when it's red. When it gives its color, it's talking about it's fermented. Least it's over 60 days old. In the cup, when it moveth itself around. Notice he's talking about the alcohol moving. Somebody say moving. Listen, it's talking about a serpent here. And last, it bite like a serpent. I know the book of Revelation 20 verse 2 calls Satan an old serpent. Somebody shout, alcohol is more than a drink. It's a spirit. Like a serpent, and stingeth like an adder. An adder is another type of serpent, more like a cobra. Hallelujah. Deadly, venomous snake. Go ahead. Verse 33. Thine eyes shall behold strange women. Somebody shout, sir, your marriage won't get better if you get drunk. You start looking where you ain't supposed to look. Come on, somebody. And thine heart shall utter perverse things. You'll curse. You'll say things you don't even remember you said when you wake up tomorrow morning with a headache. Come on, with a commode hugging blues. Come on, somebody. Throw in your guts up. Yea, thou shalt be as he that lieth down in the midst of the sea, or he that lieth upon the top of the mast. Talking about somebody sick. Come on, somebody say a drunk with a hangover. Headache. Wanting to throw up. They have stricken me, shalt thou say, and I was not sick. They have beaten me, and I felt it not. When shall I awake? I was sick and yet again. He's been beat up, and he talks about, I didn't feel a thing. This is a portrait of a drunk. And somebody's thinking, what's this got to do with a homecoming message? The only way you're going to find out, inquire minds want to know, you got to stay with me till the end. As I promise you, I'll bring it into the spirit tomorrow. Go to Isaiah, those next scriptures. Isaiah 5, verses 11. And remember, those scriptures we just read to you started out saying, who has woe? And he's talking about people that get drunk on alcohol. Hello? You know, those sipping saints. Don't you know every alcoholic was first one of them sippers?
That's right.
All I do is just sip a little toddy for the boy. Hello? Yeah, and after a while, man, you're going to be getting hammered.
Yeah.
Hello? You'll be on a bench. Hallelujah. All right, go to Isaiah 5. Next scripture is Isaiah 5:11. Woe unto them that rise up early in the morning, that they may follow strong drink that continue until night, till the wine inflame them, causes passions that are unholy and wicked to start burning in them, making them do things. They're out of control, like a fire. And the harp, look at this, there's a party going on, party hard. And the harp, and the vial, and the tavern, and the pipe, and the wine. Somebody shout, they're getting down with their tunes. Yeah, they're dancing and they're partying, partying, partying. Man, we live in such an age of that, my friend, where everybody's got to have a party. A party, a party. And parties without alcohol ain't really a party for the world. Are in their feast, but they regard not the work of the Lord. Neither consider the operation of his hands. You can't. It's okay to get drunk with wine. My people are gone into captivity. Somebody shout, the devil's got them now. Because they have no knowledge. Look at your neighbor and say, if you get drunk with wine, God says, you have no knowledge. You want to pull a Fred Sanford on yourself and look in the mirror and say, you big dummy. And they're honorable. That means they're honored. The honor that were once known for honor and respect are famished, and there will multitude dried up with thirst. That means it'll leave you broke. Listen to this now. Therefore, hell hath enlarged herself. How does hell enlarge herself? Through the alcohol that many saints are permitting themselves to drink socially. And open her mouth without measure, and their glory. Amen. That's their wealth, and he that rejoiceth shall descend into it. Those that rejoice, they've lost their praise, they've lost their victory, all because of an intoxicated drink that they permitted themselves. Somebody shall hail and enlarges through the promotion of alcohol. It ain't nothing holy about alcohol. Ain't nothing heavenly, amen, and permitted by the God of heaven when it comes to strong drink. So back to Ephesians 5:18, and we won't use no more of those scriptures that I just gave to you. I may get into 1 Corinthians 16 before we get through, but that's enough right now. You can put Ephesians 5, or put Acts chapter 2, the ones I gave you from Acts 2. Acts chapter 2, I got them out of line, out of order, but that's fine. We'll get into that in just a moment. Ephesians 5:18 again said, "Be not drunk with wine, wherein is excess." I just showed you it's a waste. From scripture, you know, it is a waste. Proverbs 31 said, amen, and this was Solomon, the wisest man, he said, a strong drink is not for king and leaders, because they'll forget the law. Hello? They break the law. You get drunk, you're going to, it doesn't matter what time, you're going to break the law. Come on, church. There's nothing good about alcohol, and that's what Paul said to the Ephesian church, don't be drunk with wine, where is this excess? But then he goes a step further. He didn't just tell them, don't be drunk with wine. He said, but let me tell you about the Most High. Let me tell you about a high. Come on, somebody, that won't give you a hangover. Let me tell you, it's called being filled with the Spirit. Somebody say, filled with the Holy Ghost. People that shoot up drugs in their veins, snort it up their nose, pop a pill, come on, somebody, or drink the liquid pill, the alcohol I just talked about. Come on, glory to God, and spill water. Amen. We're Methodists today. We'll sprinkle you if you don't want to be baptized. Praise God. Hallelujah. Amen. Bring you a bar of soap next time we come. We'll give you a shower. Hallelujah. The things I speak into you will make you clean, Jesus said in John 15:3. But anyhow, hallelujah. He was saying here, be filled with the Spirit. Meaning there's some contrast. There's some comparisons here. It's a Most High. And people that are getting drunk and getting high and abusing different substances. Amen. And drugs. And different things. They're after a feeling. They're after something to make them forget what it is they're going through. Or what they're facing. But Paul said that's a waste. But let me tell you what works. There is influence. That's what being filled with the Spirit means. It literally translates in our language to be under the influence. You know, law officers ask people when they pull them over if they've been swerving nowadays. They may not be drunk. They may just be tipsy. Glory to God. And they'll say, I perceive you're under the influence. The influence of what? Some substance. Something that has messed up your reasoning. That has messed you up. You can't discern right from left. You mixed up. Come on. Hallelujah. They're under the influence. And Paul was saying here, there is an influence of the Holy Ghost. And we're going to get into some characteristics this morning. Hallelujah. But I want to give you the title of the message because I had to build the foundation. Because I'm advocating getting drunk in the Holy Ghost. I'm not advocating getting drunk on the world's wine. Hello? And you'd be surprised if I just jumped into this message and preach what I'm about to preach. Some folks would have said, yeah, well, that preach don't go get drunk. Amen? Oh, man. Now, if all that I just got through preaching offended you, you'd have to straighten your halo up on your horn. Praise God. The title of my message is entitled Hangover Christianity. Somebody say hangover. A hangover is this. When the ecstasy becomes agony. When the high becomes a low. You may feel good tonight, some partying on, getting high. But come in the morning, you can't find enough Excedrin migraine. Your stomach is churning. You ain't reaching for God's throne. You're reaching for the Oval Office in your own house. The porcelain throne in the bathroom. Come on, somebody. Your guts feel like it's about to come out your stomach. Anybody ever been there? Come on, I know we don't know that like we ever done anything. I know. Hello? But a hangover is the result of having been drunk. And even drunk will tell you, the quickest way to get over a hangover is somebody say get drunk again. I've come to advocate this morning to the modern church, she needs to get drunk again. Because when you've got a hangover, you get sick. Somebody shout, he's preaching stuff in the spirit. Did you listen to what he just got to preach? Come on, I'm talking about stuff in the spirit now. Why do you call it hangover Christianity? I call it that simply because, amen, now they're sick. My God, I'm sick attacked. You've heard him say? Sick of prayer, sick of worship, sick of singing. Sick again. I got about to have church tonight. I'm just sick, sick, sick. Somebody shout, when you got hangover Christianity, you get sick of the things of God. Sick of holiness. Come on, somebody. Sick of doing God's will. Sick of serving others. Sick of doing, amen, his work. Somebody say, sick and tired. If that's you need to get drunk again. Because the only way to overcome a hangover is that. Somebody say, get drunk again. Hallelujah. Not being one of those satisfied Sunday morning sipping saints. Somebody say, hangover Christianity. The only way to overcome it, amen, glory to God, is to get drunk again. Let's look at Acts chapter 2. Acts chapter 2, beginning in verses 12. Hallelujah. God knows you won't believe, sir. But he can. You're saved. Verse 12, and they were all amazed. Somebody say, they were amazed. Oh God, their bottom jaw was resting on their chest. I mean, their mouths wide open, eyes stretched wide. And they were all amazed. Somebody saying, in doubt. They couldn't figure this thing out. They had no explanation of it. Saying one to another, what meaneth this? What's all this about? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Others mocking, saying, yes, it's me, said the Lord. Somebody's been asking if I was from him. Yes, it is, said the Lord. That's me talking to him. There's your answer. Others mocking said, these men are full of new wine. Somebody say, others were mocking them. They were mocking, making fun of them, speaking against them, saying, man, look at these dummies. Look at them. They act like a bunch of drunk people. Somebody shout, this is church folk. Amen. How long has it been since you had church and everybody looked like they were drunk? This was the early church. This was the first church Jesus ever started. My This is the church Jesus started. And when the people of that day saw and heard them, this was what they said. They're drunk and wild. But Peter, standing up with the 11. That makes me wonder. Because I know they were all sitting and got filled. But old Peter's having to try to get up. Come on, somebody. They look like drunk people. Somebody say, being filled with the Spirit. The contrast to being drunk and wild. Though it's a greater high, it's the most high. He's trying to get up, man. He's a little tipsy here. He may lift him up his voice and said unto them, ye men of Judea and all that dwell at Jerusalem be. And somebody said, this fellow unto you that hearken to my words. For these are not drunk as you suppose, seeing it's but the third hour of the day. Keep it there for a minute. When old preacher said years ago, he's reading his scripture, he couldn't read too good by his Beckner, and he said, ye ain't as drunk as you supposed to be. I'm afraid that's where the modern church is. She ain't as drunk as she's supposed to be. Come on, go to verse 16. But this is that. Somebody say, this is that. Which was spoken by the prophet Joel. And prophet Joel prophesied in Joel 2:28. From there on through about verse 32. He said, in the last days, God will pour out his spirit. And that's what Peter's about to reiterate here. So look at your neighbor and say, Joel's bar is still open. Sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. And on my servants and on my handmaidens, that's the women, I will pour out of my spirit in those days, and they shall prophesy, and I shall show wonders in the heaven above, signs in the earth beneath blood and fire and vapor of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before that great and notable, noticeable day of the Lord come. When it comes, it shall come to pass that whoever shall call on the name of the Lord.